Hey, Foot Clan. Today's podcast is brought to you by Reality Sports Online. It's a powerful fantasy platform that lets you build and manage a fantasy team like a real-life GM. The platform features revolutionary systems like the Free Agent Auction Room, has tons of other cool features like rookie draft and franchise tags, automated contract and salary cap functionality, much, much, much more. Visit realitysportsonline.com today and use the promo code BALLERS for 10% off the platform fee.
Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Welcome in, everybody. Welcome to the show. I'm dancing to pump myself up. You are excited because it is another day and one more day towards football.
One more day towards football, and I am the captain of this ship. I am steering the show today, my friends.
Oh, you're excited because of what we got going on.
Yeah.
I'm excited, too. I mean, we're doing a show today that has basically a bit of a game to it. Mike is running an ADP price check, and Jason and I are going to give our feedback and see if we can match up to where guys are going, whether we know off the top of our head exactly where they are, and talk about those guys. And
is it
guys.
Fair? Who's going around them? You know,
who do we take near their spot?
Doing a price check.
Yeah, and I'm excited because most of the time I'm running these games and I never get to participate because I've got the answer key. And I don't have the answer key today. That goes to Mike.
That's
the
right.
The bearded professor. We've got a good show, though. That's going on. We've got some mailbag in store. Yeah.
Yeah, that is true.
We do. There's a mailbag in the show.
Got some news, fantasy football news for everybody. A bunch of guys to catch up on. And got a good quick question, a Danny Woodhead related quick question that
those
I'm going to get to.
Always the best.
Yeah. So I'm going to get to that in just a second. So just hold your breath. Ready? All right. So if you want to visit us, we're on the web, thefantasyfootballers.com. Right now we are... The time is running out to vote for us on podcastawards.com. We've only got a few days left, and you can vote every day. So we really appreciate everybody who has been flooding our Twitter account with votes. It means a lot to have the support of the Foot Clan out there. We're nominated because of you, and if we win, it will win.
It's the only way.
It will be because of you. So thank you so much. And if you do want to vote for us, go to podcastawards.com. Vote for us in the People's Choice and the sports categories. And go ahead and go on to Twitter, share a screenshot of the confirmation page.
Make sure you verify it through your email.
Yeah, they send you an email, and you have to click it before the vote counts.
And tweet it at us. Hashtag FootClanVote. Hopefully you got in on the special weekend bonus. We dropped it on you. You were not expecting it because we were not expecting it. We said the Foot Clan support is just out of control. We need to get back. So we got a Jordan Reed autographed mini helmet that we're giving out we'll be giving out today, probably.
I'm going
to
tell you this, too. There will be another surprise in store.
Really?
It won't just be the autographed Lev Bell jersey. There will be another autographed piece of gear that we include.
And the Listener League. Don't forget about
that. And the spot in the Listener League. So we appreciate that. Wanted to bring that to your mind during this final week of voting.
Finish strong, Foot Clan.
Yes. The Horn of Gondor. And what else do we have going on? I wanted to mention we just did a giveaway on jointhefoot.com today. Gave away a David Johnson jersey and some other cool stuff. You can follow us on Twitter at the FF Ballers.
We're like fantasy Santa Claus.
Pretty much. I guess is that what you do in the preseason?
We can't stop giving stuff away.
Just give stuff away. And so a lot of good stuff going on. And let's go ahead and get into the quick question here. I brought this stat up. If you follow me on Twitter, I posted this on the 5th. And so I want to discuss it with you guys. And so here it is. Mel Gordon had 12-plus carries in 9 of 16 games last year. In the games in which he had 12 or more carries, Danny Woodhead averaged 36 yards receiving.
It's not good.
So we talk a lot about Danny Woodhead, especially in half-point and full-point per reception leagues. The fact that he has been a consistent force in fantasy, but we lean on his receiving game. And so tell me, what do you think about Mel Gordon? If he is given that role and does something with it, are we going to see Woodhead in that bust category?
Well, my first question is, when did he become Mel Gordon as opposed to Melvin Gordon?
When Twitter acquired 140 characters. That is exactly when he became Mel Gordon.
All right, so What I would say to that is there's still hope because a couple years back, it was the Danny Woodhead / Ryan Mathews show in San Diego, and that's when Ken Whisenhunt was the offensive coordinator. He left for Tennessee, failed again in spectacular Whisenhunt fashion, and is now the offensive coordinator, which he is a great offensive coordinator. And like I said, both Ryan Mathews and Danny Woodhead had monster years. That year, Woodhead had over 400 on the ground and over 600 receiving yards. So I think that Whisenhunt is okay having the roles for the guy and not just saying, Melvin Gordon, you're the three down guy. Go get it done, young man. And instead of having – he will have places for Gordon and Woodhead.
Now, yeah, Jason was shaking his head when I brought up the idea of a bust.
Yeah, he's not going to be a bust for sure. I don't think you can really draft a bust when it's, you know, seventh round and past. They might do bad, but you just don't feel like you've had a bust at the end of the day. However, I don't believe it's going to be like that. I see Danny Woodhead, if we're talking about Mel Gordon, I would call Danny Woodhead he would be the Glover to
the Mel, the lethal weapon reference.
Danny Glover.
Yes, he would be the Danny Glover to
he's
Mel.
Getting too old.
Mel Gibson. He's old, but he's still great, and he's gonna do just fine. Here's what I think about when I look at last year for the Chargers. The Chargers had this really weird season, right? They come out and they look like they're a team that can compete. They can be in the running for the playoffs from you know, I guess before game one. And then they start, and the season does not go well. And so then they really just ship everything over to Gordon and say, we've got to see what we've got here. Then he gets injured. So there was kind of like three different segments of their season, and they had dealt with so many injuries. So I look at the beginning of last year and say, how did they split those carries up? How did they use those guys? The first five games of the year of the season last year, you had Gordon with plenty of work. Only one of those games was below 12 carries. So he was getting the work. And those first five games, Danny Woodhead was fantastic for fantasy value. He had four of the five games were double-digit fantasy points, and most of the time around the 14 to 20 mark.
I don't the bust language is kind of semantical, because I realize he's not a bust if he's drafted later, but if we prop a guy up on this show,
sure.
It's an expectation bust, whether or not it's a tangible bust for the listener. So you guys don't think it's going to be a big deal. You think Woodhead is going to his role?
I think he still has his role, and he excels in that role.
All right. Easy enough. Let's go ahead and get into the news.
News and notes from around the league.
All right, Mike told me to audit this news list because he said he put a lot in there, and I only took one little bit of news out because I thought it was all pretty relevant. Let's start here with Julian Edelman. They said that sources in New England have said he will be ready for training camp.
That's, yeah, ready.
Good news.
Yeah,
right?
that's a tremendous news. Now the only thing we need to pay attention to is the Tom Brady suspension. Will that stick? Or will Julian Edelman again be a value for fantasy football drafts?
Yeah, the Tom Brady suspension is really what's on my mind. Let me ask you guys this, because I just drafted. I was down between Julian Edelman and Sammie Watkins in a PPR league, and I pulled the trigger on Sammie Watkins. I had not seen this news yet, but between everything, where would you go?
It's a very interesting foot injury conundrum you had going on with a pair of them. You took Sammie Watkins?
I did.
I think I'm...
It was best ball, so I wanted big blow-up games.
Oh, he's going to have bigger, higher ceiling games. I would have gone with Sammy
Watkins. Because it's an NFL, if you're talking a regular draft, head-to-head, Watkins,
here's what's funny
PPR,
about that.
That's tough, man.
And this may make no logical sense, which would be the first time ever for me on the show. I feel like if I had to pick one of them to be my one, I'd pick Sammy Watkins. And if I had to pick one of them to be my two, I'd pick Julian Edelman.
No, I totally get that, because you want that one who can really put up those game-winning weeks. And in that second slot, you want consistency. That's kind of how I build my roster.
That's funny, though. Because you would think if you want him to be your one, you'd want him to be your two.
There's certainly some logical inconsistency there. But it's just a matter of the makeup of how you design your team. And I think it's important to, you know, if you want to really compete at the end of the year with rosters, you're going to be going against good rosters in the playoffs. You have to have a one who can put up monster numbers.
And so, speaking of making up on a bad season, let's talk about Jordan Cameron. who took a vacation last year.
Oh, man.
He was gone, actually. He was gone the entire season, spent a year in Egypt. He was just touring, and now he's back. Or is he? It says he took a pay cut because he spoke to Julius Thomas, who told him he has to play for Adam Gase.
I like that emphasis.
So I guess that means Adam Gase is good for tight ends.
Well, yeah. I mean, we have several years of history here with Julius Thomas, Marty Bennett, the unknown Zach Miller, who hadn't touched a football field in years, all of a sudden becomes fantasy relevant and earns a new contract off of that work. So Jordan Cameron, an athletic stud, he has failed miserably in Miami. So he is a name to monitor where you shouldn't be surprised if he becomes something. And if he does not, then a guy like Deion Sims could step up. The tight end is a big part of what Adam Gase does.
Two thoughts on Jordan Cameron. One is that, is he a sign of what we'll see from Travis Benjamin, where you are kind of the only show in town in Cleveland, and as soon as you land on a new team, you disappoint on expectations? Because Cameron left a great situation in Cleveland, didn't show up here. I think that he's one of those guys, we talked about it last week, where Cameron could be one of the reasons why we would be disappointed in DeVante Parker.
Because Cameron takes work.
Like when you look at the narratives of why you might be disappointed in the second year of DeVante Parker, it could be Cameron who comes out into that
scene.
See,
and I don't expect Cameron to do very well. I like the fact that he's a flyer. If the beginning of the year it looks like he's great, I'll pick him up off of waivers. But I don't expect it, and here's why. Because going back looking at Adam Gase over the last few years, when Julius Thomas was great, he had a perfect Hall of Fame caliber Peyton Manning throwing 55 touchdowns. And so, yeah, you had DT and you had Emmanuel Sanders, and then they got Julius Thomas involved. You can't throw 55 touchdowns without involving everybody out there who can catch the ball. And then last year we saw, Martellus
couple
Bennett.
We've seen a couple years with Bennett.
No, I know. Well, not with Gase. Gase just went to Chicago this last year. Bennett was okay, and then Zach Miller was okay when Bennett went down. But I mean, you lost Brandon Marshall. Right, and you also lost Alshon Jeffrey for part of the year, and you lost Kevin White, so it was kind of a necessity. I think that DeVante Parker and Jarvis Landry will get the lion's share of work in the passing game, and I just don't think there's great chemistry there between Tannehill and Cameron, but it is worth looking at.
Yeah, I tend to agree, but don't be shocked at all. If Cameron has a great week one, I'm going to pick him up.
All right, Gary Barnidge had sports hernia surgery this past week. He will miss the mandatory minicamp, but Hugh Jackson said that he will not miss training camp, should be ready to go. Doug Peterson doesn't seem impressed with Jordan Matthews' ability on the outside, saying he is better off on the inside.
You know what time it is. Rueben Randle!
I don't know how the story isn't how sad Jordan Matthews really is, but...
Well, yeah, it's Jordan Matthews is a sad man, but I've got to move on from the sadness to the gladness. And that is me thinking about Rueben Randle.
I can see the My Guys episode already. And your guy is Rueben Randle.
We're not going that far yet, but somebody's got to play the outside for the Eagles.
And so Randle is more than capable of putting up a wide receiver 2 year.
I think you guys should have a perfect water bet here between Andy's beloved Nelson Aguilar and your Rubes.
We'll see. We'll see.
I don't think either of us know whether we would want to take that bet. That's a great question. I may swear off Philadelphia Eagle bets all year, however. Back to Adam Gase. I don't know why we didn't talk about this, too. He did say that he wanted all his running backs to play three downs. If they don't bring somebody in, this is good for Jay Ajayi?
Yes.
Okay. In an interview with Showtime Tuesday night, Marshawn Lynch confirmed that he is indeed retired.
Yeah, it's sad.
Mike said he was just sad for the NFL. Well, it's kind of like when Favre leaves, you just lose a character for the game.
Yeah, it's Marshawn Lynch, I think. The NFL is better when Marshawn Lynch is playing, but he's done.
He hasn't spent any of his money.
Smart.
I was going to say, it's a wise man.
His friend came out and said that even when they're at the, like, you know, at a restaurant and the guy's like, how much is this? He's like, $55. Marshawn's like, no. He'll get something for 20, or 25. Like, he's a pretty frugal guy.
That's smart, man.
Yeah, he does, and he wants to do a lot in his community back home where he grew up.
Right.
I think it was Oakland. And so now he can. So free agent Joik Bell has come out and let the world know he has at least two contract offers on the
table. Yeah,
right. No, I wrote him in. Did you not see the check?
Yeah,
the
I saw the notes you put in here. You said it was one was for Target and one was for Pizza Hut.
Oh, man.
Which would you take, Target or Pizza Hut?
Target.
Well, if you're your first job, if you're Joint Bell, you take Pizza Hut.
First job, first job after the NFL, I go Pizza Hut.
No, yeah. What, dude? Target, you gotta get that Target discount. I'm
he,
all about
he
it.
Have the money to shop
when we
at Target.
When we go to Target to pick up stuff for the studio or the show. Mike is the one who is obsessively
with the cartwheel.
He's Marshawn Lynching on
yes.
his phone, trying to get an internet connection to save 4 cents on a. You know, a can of LaCroix or something.
Hey, when we have those 4 cents in the bank account, you can thank me.
Let me ask you
and then
guys
he goes
this.
And spends it all on pristineauction.com.
Yeah.
You mind your business.
do you guys actually think that Joik Bell has two teams or multiple teams interested in him?
Sure.
No.
Yeah. Yes. I don't. I actually no. don't. When I saw that news pass, I was like, yeah, right.
No, he does because guys like Robert Turbin have jobs. And Joik Bell is 29 years old, so he's not...
Yeah,
he's not out of it.
That's
you know,
fair.
He's he wasn't healthy and wasn't good, but neither was any. No running back on the Lions were good. They'll give him a shot somewhere.
All right,
he'll come into Miami and ruin that situation.
Oh no!
All right, last bit of news: Michael Thomas from the Saints. There was some news last week. He had earned the trust of Drew Brees in some special way.
It was
going to
be the big
some,
slot, the but, big slot.
But at least one of the reporters there in New Orleans thinks he won't beat out Brandon Coleman, who. I've said it before, Brandon Coleman just kind of finds his way into the hearts of the coaching staff or Drew Brees. I don't know why. I don't think Coleman has much in him, but it just shows that Michael Thomas is a work in progress as a rookie. You don't know what you're going to get from him.
Yeah. I think one of those two guys will ultimately win out. I don't think they're going to really
eat
into each other, swip swap. Drew Brees wants to find a guy and build a rapport with him. He saw it with Willie Snead, and I think that by the time training camp is over and we get into preseason, I'm going to be watching game three of preseason to see which one of those two guys is predominantly taking the snaps in that big slot role, because I think one of those two guys will be valuable for fantasy.
All right. Well, before we get into that is it with the news. So there was a lot. Before we get into the ADP price check, I do want to take a minute and remind everybody about UltimateDraftKit.com. We just recently released the Ultimate Draft Kit. This is our replacement for those old magazines you used to have to go buy and get all the outdated information inside of them.
I believe the word you were looking for is upgrade.
This is the upgrade.
For those old magazines.
Yeah, and we've had a lot of really, really good feedback from people that are inside the Draft Kit and using it. Premium rankings, over 100 videos. A lot of people are telling us that they're watching the videos at work. I don't know if we condone that.
We do. Absolutely do. Yes.
All right, we do. And so check it out, ultimatedraftkit.com. Grab that. And we update it all the time, all off season. So you're going to get new stuff all throughout the off season. You ready to get into it?
Yeah.
You better check yourself before you wreck yourself.
All right. I feel kind of weird out of place here starting everything off. We are doing an ADP price check. These are from fantasyfootballcalculator.com. I took standard ADP, and I just found a couple guys
now
who...
Now, that's the average draft position. Is
that
correct?
That is ADP stands for the average draft position.
Yeah.
And so I grabbed a couple guys where I thought their price point was interesting, maybe too high, maybe too low, and they have... interesting players around them
sure.
as well. So we're going to start off this conversation with the newly signed counterpoint there up in Detroit. We're talking about Marvin Jones for the Detroit Lions, who Andy seems to be rising a little bit on that offense as a whole.
Yeah, so, we talked a lot about Matt Stafford.
So where do you think Marvin Jones is currently going?
Oh, this is fun. This
drafts.
Is fun. I got to give it some thought here. So we'll take turns going first, I think.
Sure,
yeah,
you want to do that? So I'm going to say that I think Marvin Jones is going in the – I'm going to say he's going in the eighth round.
Eighth round. Jason, do you
I'm
going to
say the seventh round.
Okay, Jason said the seventh round. He is actually going at the back of the ninth.
Woo! Oh!
The
I like
back
that value.
Of the ninth.
Yeah, that
there's nothing
pretty-
to, there's nothing to dislike about that. You get a guy who's coming into a new system, could possibly be the
he
one.
He could be huge.
And definitely a red zone threat. And you get him at a place where you're not risking very much. I mean, I like that value a lot more than I do settling into somebody in a round or two earlier that you know has a really defined low ceiling role in an offense.
Both of the wide receivers there provide a good value. I actually really like Golden Tate this year. I think he's, in my opinion, a lock for 100 catches, which is great. And he's going near the back of the fourth. But like you said, Andy, we don't know yet that split between Marvin Jones and Golden Tate. And if it so turns out that Marvin Jones is used like a one there, or he's even anywhere close, getting him at the back of the ninth, that provides a – I mean, he has to be a higher upside guy than guys in the ninth.
Yeah, the guys going just in front of him currently, Stephon Diggs.
Kimmy Jones.
Travis Benjamin.
Jones.
Marcus Wheaton.
Jones. That's close, but Jones.
Doriel Green-Beckham.
I would take Jones.
I would as well.
And so I wanted to...
You know what's funny about those guys that you just mentioned? Stephon Diggs and Dorsett Green-Beckham specifically, just totally capped offenses.
Right.
Just offenses that you cannot see volume going to those wide receivers.
So I wanted to cap off that question with, so you got Marvin Jones in the back of the ninth or Golden Tate, like Jason said, he's at the back of the fourth. We're in standard. Who would you rather draft?
Standard league?
Yeah.
Ah, God.
Standard league, the value is better on Jones because I think Jones is a great big-bodied red zone threat.
I will take Jones in a standard league with that value.
Honest to goodness, I would like both of them. I don't feel like you have to pick one and say the other is a guy you avoid. I would look for both of them and see how my draft turns out.
Yeah, I completely agree. I think that Marvin Jones at the back of the ninth would be.
That's interesting.
I think that's crazy that people are sleeping on him so much and just thinking that it's Golden Tate 100%.
And we love Golden Tate.
We all like him a lot, especially
in PPR leagues.
But if it turned into not a 1-2 into like a 1A, 1B, would you be shocked?
Not at all, because nobody sees Golden Tate as one. I mean, they don't.
Right.
Golden Tate he's a 1B type of guy.
All right, we're going to move on to another wide receiver two on his team. And that is a man. He's got a new quarterback coming into town. He's got a fresh, fancy Super Bowl ring. Emmanuel Sanders.
Oh, you get to start this one first.
Where is he being drafted?
Gross.
I have thoughts on him, too.
Check yourself before you wreck yourself.
All right, so Emmanuel Sanders, a guy who last year was drafted pretty much as a wide receiver one or very high-end wide receiver two.
Came off a career year.
Now he has fallen from grace, has no quarterback. I'm going to say he is being drafted in the seventh round.
I don't think people have faded him that far. I'm going to predict that he's been being taken in the fifth round.
He is being taken at 5-12, the back of the fifth round.
Are we keeping score here? Because that's two to nothing.
I can keep scoring. Oh, you got the score over there?
Sure.
All right. Wait.
You get a point for the first one? Well, just because you were closer?
You have to predict the exact draft position?
Well, I'm just saying. You got fifth
yes,
round.
Yes, just because
right.
I'm closer. I win because I won.
All right, I mean, if you want to change the scoring, then he would have gotten 2 points for that one because he got the round exactly right.
No, my point was and you'd be we down both by got three. The round wrong on the first one.
But he was closer.
All right, go on.
I get it. But, right, but I'll
said
take the point.
You said you have an Emmanuel Sanders take. I want to hear this.
Yeah, and I think the take is that I'm a little too low on Emmanuel Sanders. I mean, that it's not a long story. That's the story is that, you know, he's a very talented guy. He's been productive for years, and I think, you know, as long as the targets are there, he produces. So he's not anywhere near what he was when that offense was focused around the passing game. And, you know, you talked about the Peyton Manning miracle year of 55 were long departed, but he's 29 years old. He still gets loose deep all the time, and they take deep shots to him, and he kind of comes down with everything. So I think, you know, I say all that, and then I think about him going 5-12. I'd be excited to get him there.
Yeah, he still had over 1,000 yards. You're talking 76 receptions, over 1,100 yards, and 6 touchdowns.
But Mike.
Oh, geez. Yes, voice of public opinion.
But Mike, Peyton Manning left, and now they've got a butt fumbler, and they've got a rookie.
Peyton Manning was an abomination last year. You speak to my point that Sanders – with garbage throwing him the football was over 1,100 yards, which in retrospect, when you look at it, that's an unbelievable season.
Let me hijack the segment for 1 second because I can't help myself. Emmanuel Sanders at the back of the fifth or Marvin Jones in the ninth. because you just said Sanders in a okay year is over 1,000 yards. That's something Marvin Jones has never done.
Right.
You're talking about four rounds.
Proven production going in, but the team is either Paxton Lynch or Mark Sanchez.
I would take Jones.
Give me Jones.
For value there. I like the offense better as far as for wide receivers. And he could be, you're talking about the number two for each guy. I would much rather have Matthew Stafford throwing the ball than whoever it's going to be for Denver.
All right.
All right, let's keep this wide receiver two train chugging along.
Oh. Wait, is it Amir Abdullah here?
Amir Abdullah is not a wide receiver two. He is a running back 15 because he was really bad last
year. Yeah. So who do we have?
We're talking about a man who had double-digit touchdowns. He just signed himself a very lucrative contract.
Which I love.
Especially considering that this man was undrafted. He was an undrafted free agent. Of course, I'm talking about Mr. Allen Hurns in Jacksonville. Where is he being drafted?
Allen Hurns sure grew on a lot of people last year.
Well, 10 touchdowns will do that.
Yeah, he was somebody who you started to be able to rely on week in and week out, especially during the beginning and middle part of the season. I'm going to predict sixth round.
Sixth round. Jason, you're on the clock.
Man, that sounds like a really good prediction here.
Over 1,000 yards and 10 touchdowns.
I will say this. I think he would go behind Emmanuel Sanders. So if Emmanuel Sanders is 5'12", then I would go to the sixth since Andy's already there.
So then we need to split the...
Yeah, I need to hear a 6.
I will go 6.8.
I'm going to go...
Right?
6.7.
Jason is on the board.
Ah! Yes!
Because... I should actually retract your point because Allen Hurns is being drafted in front of Emmanuel Sanders.
Oh,
all right.
Oh, okay. Well, I still get the point.
He is going at...
I was really hoping he was in the sixth round.
He is averaging fifth round, seventh pick.
So right around Sanders.
A wide receiver, two on his team. But like I said, over 1,000 yards and 10 touchdowns. But when you look at the statistics of how many touchdowns Bortles was throwing when the team was down, and down a lot, ultimate garbage time last year for Blake Bortles. Can you count on Allen Hurns moving forward?
A little bit, but not...
A little bit.
Yeah, well, that's the truth. I think Allen Hurns is going to be a serviceable wide receiver this year. They paid him money. They're keeping him in that role. But will he get 10 touchdowns this year? No, probably not. He might... He's still a very talented guy who has the trust of Bortles. So I could see him getting 7 or 8 touchdowns and keeping up the same amount of receptions and yards. But I see a slight regression from last year for him. And so I would say he is not the best value ahead of, like we just said, ahead of Emmanuel Sanders. I would rather have Emmanuel Sanders than Allen Hurns on my team.
Allen Hurns had 16.1 yards per catch compared to his counterpart, Allen Robinson, 17.5. He was at 1,000 yards where Allen Robinson had 1,400 yards. Do you like the value for Allen Robinson in the first more than Hurns here?
Well, and the actual truth is Allen Robinson has now slipped back into the second round currently. So if you're talking about Allen Robinson in the second.
Yeah, I take Allen Robinson in the second.
Allen Robinson in the second every day.
All right.
Over
Hurns. Okay. All right. Who's next?
All right. Let's move. Let's keep it rolling.
2-1.
It's 2-1. Keep it rolling here. And we are going to go to. I'm picking off my list here. Who do I want to go to? All right. We're going to go to who could have been the go-to receiver last year for the new rookie. The new rookie in Tennessee, he needed a target. And we're not talking about Delanie Walker. We're talking about a wide receiver. And he had his weeks, but then he got hurt. Kendall Wright. Kendall Wright, where is he being drafted?
Man, I wish you were picking first here, Andy, because I would take the over on whatever you pick by one spot. So it's a matter of how far back. I think that he is not shiny. People don't like Kendall Wright. They want Dorial Green-Beckham. They like other options there other than Kendall Wright. So I'm going to say Kendall Wright is going to be in the 11th round.
I'll take the 12th round.
He's way past that.
Kendall Wright is going at the back of the 13th round.
I gave it to you, Andy.
In 10 games, Kendall Wright was able to scrounge up 36 receptions for just over 400 yards and 3 touchdowns. Now, Kendall Wright is interesting to me. And he's now we're coming off a second year of being very inconsistent after his kind of his breakout year.
Yeah, he had 94 receptions back in 2013.
94, almost 1,100 yards. So people were expecting big things, and it still has not happened.
So you're telling me I can get him in the 13th round?
That's what I'm telling you.
When I'm on the board in the 13th round, I'm going to pass.
Really?
Yeah, I'm going to pass. Because like Andy just brought up, the offense for Tennessee is not going to produce a lot of passing weapons. And so you've got Delanie Walker. You've got Doriel Green Beckham. You've got Rashad Mathews that just came in. You've got Kendall Wright. Who's it going to be? Probably no one. It's probably going to be a No, I'm saying it's probably going to be spread around to everyone. So Doriel Green Beckham here probably is the best red zone target. So his fantasy production at the end of the year might be highest. But I just don't want to put chips on a low output, spread the ball around type of offense.
Kendall Wright at this point is a guy who, if I'm an NFL team, I love having him on my team. He's a gamer. He's a great player, former first-round pick. He's only 26 years old. But in his career, he has 15 touchdowns, and that's four seasons. He's not going to score the ball. And so then you're just relying on, can he summon up a 94 reception season again and give you kind of an okay week? I mean, a game, and it's not going to happen. Jason's right. Rashard Mathews, Green Beckham, Walker, out of the backfield, you'll have a lot of receptions for DeMarco Murray and Wright. I think Wright will contribute. I think it will give you okay games. I think in a full PPR, he's worth a flyer late, but that's about it.
Yeah, give me Rueben Randle, who's probably going past that.
Just to see what you have on the outside in Philly.
When I'm drafting in the 13th round plus, I'm looking for high upside guys.
Right.
Kendall Wright's upside is that, he gets 90 receptions for, 910 yards and one touchdown.
Okay.
I think Wright, if you're in a PPR, is okay to throw a dart at him.
Right.
If I'm in a standard league at all, no. I'll pass. I'll find somebody else.
He's got a nice last name, though.
What's the best?
All right. Next guy.
We built airplanes. All right, we're going to do a
built our place. Your brothers did.
Yeah. Yes. We're going to check in on a running back here.
All right.
A running back that
It's Michael Turner.
A running back that may or may not do something for your team. If he has given the when he was given the opportunity, he was a top 5 running back. But that was only because he inherited the opportunity because of injury.
I know who he is.
We're talking about the ultimate handcuff from last year, DeAngelo Williams.
Oh, yeah, you don't get much better than DeAngelo Williams as a handcuff. As a handcuff.
Give me that price check on DeAngelo Williams.
I think he's probably going too high. I'm going to predict a 7th round.
Oh, I'll definitely take 8th there.
You got me in the middle of a drink there, fellas. I thought there would be some banter. He is going at currently the 8th pick of the 8th round.
2-2 tie game.
The game is
tied. Because I won last round, so it's 3-1.
Really?
Yeah. The one that you screamed, I gave it to you, I get credit for that
one. Oh, sure. But I
so
just
that's
won.
3-2.
3-2. All right.
Yeah. No, so when you clenched your fist and you went, tie game, you were wrong.
Just wait till the next one, all right?
Yeah. Okay.
All right. So
that was a close one, though.
Let's talk about DeAngelo Williams, a running back who will – it's possible – in the realm of possibilities that DeAngelo Williams sits on your bench for a whole year and does nothing but clog up a spot and give you insurance. A guy you have to take in at least the 8th round right now.
On the other hand, he's a guy who led the league in touchdowns last year, which is an incredible stat.
That's a valid point.
We have a guy in our league who every week on Sunday morning would drop somebody off his roster and pick up DeAngelo Williams just for the weekend, just in case. I think
And then it happened.
And you had the best running back in the league for a few weeks.
I think the ADP of him in the 8th round is great. Because it's not something where
it's just fine, yeah.
It's for the guy that drafted Le'Veon Bell. If you drafted Le'Veon Bell, reach. I think the 8th is a reach for the type of player you're getting in DeAngelo Williams, but you're locking up, a surefire number one running back spot for, let's say you've got a 2 running back and maybe a flex. Well, you've taken half of your running back spots out by doing that. Now you just have to find it at the most 1 running back through streaming or through other means if necessary. So I think that the ADP is fine there. And if you're a Lev Bell owner,
Let's say you're not. You are not a Le'Veon Bell owner. Would you be willing to take that gamble to grab DeAngelo Williams in the 8th, to either have as a chip on your bench or as maybe a bargaining chip for the other, for the actual Lev Bell owner?
I probably wouldn't, but that depends on who's on the board. So why don't you tell us a couple of running backs that are going right near DeAngelo Williams, and let's pretend we don't have Le'Veon Bell on our team and see whether or not we think the upside of one guy or the other is better.
All right, so you, these are the guys who are going just behind DeAngelo Williams. Rashad Jennings, Isaiah Crowell, Tevin Coleman, and LeGarrette Blount.
I would take all of those guys ahead of DeAngelo Williams.
You would take Coleman over DeAngelo?
Yes.
I would take all but Blount over DeAngelo. I think that what you're looking at there is you're looking at opportunity that doesn't need an injury to be big. Isaiah Crowell could be great this year with Hugh Jackson.
with Wolverine.
We need an over-under.
We've had that before.
How many times that'll happen?
Oh, but man, that's going to keep happening. I can tell you that right now. It's Hugh Jackman. Anyways, LeGarrette Blount, if it's not a best ball league where you don't have to pick the week, I can't stand having him on my team. So at that point, I would go DeAngelo Williams, maybe ahead of him. But yeah, most of those guys, if I don't have Lev Bell, I'm looking to give me an option that doesn't require an injury to be productive.
Well, and let me be honest, D-Will is probably the best handcuff in the league, but he's 33. He's not like a spring chicken here. He's a backup for a reason. Like, it could have been a bit of an outlier coming back from the great performance last year. I'm certainly not going to want to spin that pick with those other guys on the board, have them sit on my bench and just like hope for an injury. That's just not how I play fantasy football.
All right. We're going to stick with the running backs here. A guy who, you know that I love him, and but does the rest of the world love him? And that is Ryan Mathews up in Philadelphia.
Whose turn is it to pick first? I think it's Jason's.
I don't remember.
I think it is mine.
Okay, well then you go, Jay. So I don't remember.
Oh, man. Ryan Mathews. He's climbing for sure. I wonder how high he's got. I'm going to think he's either back of the third or early fourth. I'm going to go.
He's frozen.
Three.
Frozen with fear.
Nine.
3-9. Okay.
I'll go 4-1. I don't know why I didn't just go 3-10, but yeah, I'll go 4-1.
That's how the game...
Out of integrity.
Whenever we have these games, they devolve.
Jason does it. He wants to win. I want to be accurate. I think 4-1. I think right at the beginning of the fourth round.
And you both are still too early because he is currently going in the middle of the fifth round.
That's ridiculous.
That is a win for Andy.
That's not a realistic average draft position.
That's where he is right now, but Jason's right. He is climbing. So let's just talk
so
about
where has he gone
where
in the
does,
past?
Where okay. does the climb stop? Where is Ryan Mathews going to be
top of the
when
third
draft season opens up?
Top of the third. If nothing
top
changes.
Top of the third to you.
Top of the third. If nothing changes in Philadelphia, I mean, how does he not climb that high?
Right.
I mean, you had TJ Yeldon going in the second round last year because of opportunity in Jacksonville. I don't know how in the world you would let Ryan Mathews, who was so productive last year in his limited work, not go higher than that. I would say the top of the third, back of the second.
Yeah.
That's where I think he'll actually go.
And would you be willing to draft him in the third?
I would 100.
If nothing changed in the backfield,
I would take him in the third, and I would love it. I mean, that would be one of the best picks you can get. He would be the number one guy for an offense. What we know about Doug Peterson is that he's had a top running offense every single year he's been the offensive coordinator, led the league in rushing touchdowns last year despite losing Jamal Charles. And so he's going to institute that type of a game for Philly.
He also got no choice with the quarterback situation.
Right. And with the running back situation. Very few guys behind him. Kenyon Barner.
Yeah.
Wendell Smallwood.
Yeah, I agree with you guys. I've professed my love for Ryan Mathews many a times.
You've wrote him many letters.
Many.
Why doesn't he come on the show?
I wish.
This is a public.
This is a public. Oh, we're pining?
A public invitation to Ryan Mathews. If you want to come on the show, hang out with us, talk about Philadelphia and the change at the in the coaching staff, your opportunity there. We'd love to have you on the show.
I love Ryan Mathews so much.
That's the end of the story.
For my fantasy team, I would be perfectly happy going wide receiver, and having Ryan Mathews as my running back one. I believe in the opportunity that much.
Yeah, you now, better believe in the collarbones.
Yeah,
too.
So can the bones hold up?
Maybe.
That remains to be seen.
All right, what's next?
All right, next on the list, he is, say, the other half of a a newly formed dynamic duo up in Seattle. We're talking, of course, about the rookie sensation that is Tyler Lockett, who really did not do a whole lot for the first half of the season, but he eventually earned his way into more playing time, earned some more trust, and had a pretty strong real production and fantasy output for the second half. So where is Tyler Lockett going in drafts?
I'm a big fan of Tyler Lockett, the player. I think that he is going in the eighth round. That's where I think he's going right now.
Tyler Lockett is probably going in the ninth round. So I'm going to go nine.
Tyler Lockett is going at the back of the seventh round.
Wow.
Jason is getting his behind torched in the ADP price check challenge.
I think I just give people too much credit. They would draft like I would.
Yeah, if everybody was like you, you'd get this. You'd nail this thing 5-2. All right, so he's going back at the seventh. Did he just move up there?
That I believe he has just moved
up
there.
So he's climbing. That makes sense. I think the gap between him and Baldwin is going to start to close a little bit, because it should. In my opinion, I would still take Lockett over Baldwin and their current values and where they're at. I think one more off season with Russell Wilson for Tyler Lockett, the kind of kid he is, the kind of player he is, he's every bit as valuable in the red zone as Baldwin is if he just learns the system. So I think he's the better value.
And see, that's where I disagree with you, is the red zone. Red zone to me is where Doug Baldwin will be utilized and featured in the red zone. And I don't believe Tyler Lockett will be featured in the red zone to the same degree of Doug Baldwin. But I'm curious, because that was so much higher than where I think he should go, tell me some of the wide receivers that are around Lockett there. I want to see if
you take him or you take somebody else.
Yeah.
I'm pulling him up as
I'm not anti Tyler Lockett.
Sorry. So Tyler Lockett,
you're wearing an anti Tyler Lockett t-shirt right now.
Tyler Lockett. So you want the guys who are going in front of him?
Sure. In front, behind.
All right. So around. We got Steve Smith is still in here. People still hoping that he comes back.
No way.
Kevin White, John Brown, Devontae Parker, Eric Decker.
You just named four guys that I love and I would absolutely love to have ahead of Tyler Lockett. Those aren't even
all
in this
of them. I would not take all those names. I would not take. Goodness. I would take Tyler Lockett over Kevin White.
Oh, I would take Kevin White over. Well, there you go. We'll put that on.
Based on his long history of success.
That is very interesting. Okay, well, let's go.
You want a water bet, Tyler?
I do want a water
bet.
This
has gotten out of control.
And Kevin White?
Yes. Yes.
Oh, the drop.
No.
I'm just thinking about it.
Oh.
Water bet.
So we have an official water bet of Kevin White versus
Tyler Lockett.
I'm
going to
Tyler
get
Lockett.
A locket and put Tyler Lockett in my locket and wear it around my neck to remind me of how I'm going to defeat
you
this year.
And then,
you
while you're
put
sleeping,
it in your pocket.
I'm going to take that locket and I'm going to switch the picture to Kevin White. And at the end of the year, when you open it to muse with Tyler Lockett and cry tears on him at what Kevin White did, you'll open it and Kevin White will be staring back with his beautiful smile.
All right, well, here's guys going behind Tyler Lockett. So you're making
By
the
way,
move.
I would take Decker over Tyler Lockett.
Okay. And these are guys where you are making a choice. You want Lockett in front of these guys. So Dante Moncrief, DeSean Jackson, Michael Crabtree, and Dorial Green-Beckham.
I would take Lockett over all those guys except for maybe D-Jax.
I would take Moncrief and D-Jax ahead of
that's
Lockett.
That's fine.
I'm with
fair.
Jason on that.
Totally
I
fair.
Would take those two guys.
But I will say this. If that's kind of where the breakdown goes, then I don't see Lockett as a ninth-round pick. He's probably deserving to be a little bit lower than he is now, but not
public invitation to
seventh.
Tyler Lockett to come
what
on
are
the
we,
show.
What are we doing?
All right. I want my guy on here, too.
All right,
Lockett's one of my guys to go with Who's the other guy that I have this offseason so
far? Aguilar?
No, not Aguilar.
I hope people think
TJ Yeldon.
Oh, yeah. Yeldon is your guy for
I
sure.
I hope people think that Aguilar is really your guy.
No,
but if we
they
say
don't
it enough,
think Matt
if
Stafford,
we keep repeating
Matt
it.
Stafford is.
All right. We're going to finish it up here with a man who Jason has a couple of choice words for him.
Oh, he stinks.
And he says he stinks.
This is great.
And but on top of he stunk last year. However, he is still technically the third wide receiver for the Green Bay Packers, a very high powered offense. Usually not so much last year, but we've seen Green Bay sustain fantasy production for three wide receivers in the past when they had a guy like Jordy Nelson there who is an actual one. Then the guys behind can get production. Of course, I'm talking about Davante Adams. He stinks.
Now, real quick, because what I care about is the game. Is this worth five times the points on this last one?
Nope.
All right, then how many rounds does this data go? Because I'm going to go however many rounds plus one.
Okay.
No, I would say he's probably going in the ninth round.
I'll go deeper. I think 11th round.
He is the last registered wide receiver in this data.
Good.
He is going at the back of the 14th round.
Yeah.
Davante Adams.
I wouldn't touch him with a 10-foot pole.
Really?
Because I don't care. What does a comeback year even mean for Davante Adams?
You've got
Jordy Nelson. The opportunity doesn't get better than the last year.
I think you're hoping that what you get is James Jones from a couple years ago.
That's exactly why I brought him up.
But he's not James Jones. He's not big enough to go be that red zone, throw it up to him. He blew so many important plays. It's over for him.
Completely agree.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Davante Adams.
I'm going to give you 3 points for agreeing with me.
Thank you. Davante Adams is not good enough there. And what you're going to see with Aaron Rodgers is he likes going to the guys that are good, and he will start.
Oh, he'll get catches because he's settled into this comfy little three, you know, the 3-4 spot where he can just come in and make
so
a couple non-important plays.
Aberdare.
I say that we're getting a little hot takey here, but so if Adams is not the three,
he's the three. Adams
okay,
is the three.
So
I just
Adams
don't like
Adams is
him.
Still the three for you.
For me, he is.
Jason, has Adams been demoted? Do you
in
send
his
him
heart,
to the bench?
I believe that Davante Adams is probably going to be the three. I hope that Aberdare can beat him out in that third role by the midseason.
Now, you like Ty Montgomery too, though, right?
I do, but I worry a little bit about his health. He had that ankle that has taken a bizarrely long time to heal. He's still not back to
full
strength.
Like a Safarian Jenkins?
Like a Perryman?
Yeah, more like a Perryman. And so I'm kind of – I did like him, but now Aberdaris to me looks like the guy. If I'm in a dynasty league, I've talked about this with Mike, Aberdaris is one of my targets.
All right, final score was
the Foot Clan wants to know what this guy has to say sometimes.
No, they don't.
Yeah, they do.
Now you know what I feel like.
Yeah, well,
I feel like you got to move on before you even
talk. No. Well, I would have moved us on, but I'm asserting myself. And I am of the opinion Davante Adams is not the three, and I am on Team Janis to be the third wide receiver.
It's funny because there are a lot of different opinions about that second-tier guy in Green Bay.
Well,
so.
I think whoever is the three will have fantasy relevance now that the team is back to full strength.
And we will find out. Let's get into the mailbag.
Mailbag.
Mailbag! Yeah! All right, if you have a fantasy football question, head to the website, thefantasyfootballers.com. Click the Submit a Question button. You can also dial us at 302-464-TFFB. Leave a voicemail question. And if you are a member of jointhefoot.com, the priority question tier, all your questions are answered on the website as well. So let's check out, let's go to...
Did you want me to parse that one a little bit more?
Well, these are all very long. Catfish7 in Ohio, down there at the bottom. I've been hearing a lot of talk about this zero running back theory. I was wondering what your thoughts are on the theory. Thanks again for all the knowledge. This is a PPR 10-team league. What are your thoughts on zero RB, Mike?
Sure. It depends on your team or the makeup of your league. Like, how many players are you starting? You're in a PPR, so that's a good start. For it to really succeed, I mean, there's actually a really great breakdown on the new Fantasyland pod if you want to check it out. But if you have PPR and you can play, you know, 3-4 wide receivers, then I'm on board with it in that format, that if you can load up with super studs there and then you just play the variance, you play that there's these pass-catching running backs that you can plug in and find, and or these handcuffs that you can acquire, then I am completely on board with it if the scoring setting and the league, the active roster is right.
Well, for this, it's a 10-team league, and so I would lean away from it a little bit more in a 10-team league. Just because what you're going to have is you're going to have every roster with a bunch of absolute studs. And your late flyers aren't going to compete, I don't believe, as well with the teams that have solid running backs, solid wide receivers, solid every position. You know, when you're in a deeper league, and like you said, more wide receivers, so it depends on how many people you're starting, then you can use that strategy. It's this is a good year for it. I will say that. Last year was probably the best year that we've seen for it in forever.
I'm just not one to kind of have a rigid, you know, unless it's a peripheral league that I'm trying to test something on. I don't really want to go in and say, okay, I'm going to do, you know, wide receiver, wide receiver, wide receiver, and then I'm going to draft my running back in this exact round.
The interesting thing for me is what if you end up in a draft where, I mean, everyone's taking a wide receiver. If let's say eight of those first 10 picks are wide receivers. So, I mean, you're now down into the second tier of wide receivers while you have the prime primo running top tier running back sitting there looking at you. Could you pass on them for a second tier wide receiver? I don't know that I could.
You'd have to if you locked yourself in.
Exactly. That's why you don't lock yourself in. Take the best player there.
Brian in Irvine, California. What lottery ticket guys are you looking at? Sammie Coates has been mine in the last few times he's used fantasydraftwizard.com. He said, thanks again for the tip on that site. Yeah, we like that site.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel good about Sammie Coates, but you guys probably have some other or better suggestions for kind of basically lottery ticket guys. Guys that you take late in the draft that have a lot of upside. Guys that could surprise. You know, Andrew Hawkins is the name we've been throwing out this week in the studio. When
Terrell
you talk about
Pryor.
Even Terrell Pryor, guys that you're like, okay, somebody has to catch the ball in Cleveland.
Dirty.
Somebody has to catch it in Cleveland. I think, you know, yeah. What kind of role does Mohamed Sanu have in Atlanta as a two? You know, you saw twos with relevance last year. They paid him money. They brought him in. I think Tavon Austin's volume.
Yes.
Is a great name.
Of any names you've thrown out so far, that's probably the highest. I'm high on Sammie Coates.
You're high on Kamar Aiken.
Yeah, I love Kamar Aiken as well, just from a matter of circumstance. I think that he ends up playing another big role. The aforementioned Jeff Janis, I think he's a great late-round pick.
What about Phillip Dorsett?
It's very possible.
If Moncrief continues to struggle getting back from his injury, then Dorsett is one of those, you know, deeper sleeper guys that could be kind of a lottery ticket.
Sleeper.
I think even without that, I believe that their offense is going to shift. I mean, they're going to go – I think they're going to go three wide because they had Dwayne Allen and Colby Fleener, and they were trying to emulate this two tight end Patriots set, and I think now they're trying to emulate something else so that you have the three wides. It's baffling to us, and me especially, how you can spend a first-round pick on Dorsett and not have an immediate place for him. So I think that they'll switch to three wide, which could lead to more just regular week-to-week Dorsett value.
Looking at our ultimate draft kit as well, Chris Hogan would be someone you can get
Chris Hogan, great.
Very, very late. That's just one of those lottery ticket type guys. If he ends up with that number one outside receiver role for Tom Brady, who's probably going to come back and in four fewer games break the touchdown record with fury. I would want a piece of that. We saw LaFell finish as a wide receiver one a couple of years ago.
All right, Nick in Eau Claire, Wisconsin. So I have a friend who won our fantasy league a few years ago, and we ran in a two-quarterback league. He won the first season, and upon winning fantasy basketball and baseball seasons as well, he declared himself a fantasy god and retired. 2 years ago, he came out of retirement and hasn't gotten close to winning
Jordan.
Since. Yeah, Jordan in baseball.
We're in the 4-5.
We've also gone to a 1QB. He continues to argue for a 2QB system, saying it makes the league more fun. What are the pros and cons of a 2-quarterback system? Does it make it more fun?
Yes.
Guys, set it straight. Does it make it? Did you say yes?
I did say yes.
You like 2 quarterbacks is more fun?
Not necessarily more fun, because I can't even have more fun than I already have in my leagues, and
it's
most of them are quarterbacks.
It's too much fun.
But I will say this. Whenever I decide what's more fun, what's less fun, it always comes down to more strategy for me. Like, I don't like the kickers because I feel like the strategy isn't there. But I like the fab because there's more strategy every week of save money, spend money. I like adding more things that make more decisions. The quarterbacks right now are, I guess I have a lot of fun streaming, which you don't do in a 2-quarterback. But I would say for the draft, it makes quarterbacks valued more like they are in the NFL. Both are great systems. If you want to stream and have an easier time beating the average fantasy football guy out there, then do a 1-quarterback league.
Yeah, I agree. It's 2 quarterbacks. It increases the scarcity for the quarterback, so their importance skyrockets. But as a matter of fun, I mean, that's just personal. I love the challenge of trying to get a late round quarterback, see if it hits. And then if it doesn't, then week to week, like going full, like, I'm trying to think of a good analogy, but just stones. That's all I could throw out there of, like, do you have the courage, the intestinal fortitude to throw out Josh McCown versus the Ravens when he ends up as the highest scoring quarterback of the week because you knew it was a great matchup?
I
like that stuff.
I'm going to amend my answer. Honestly, the more that I think about this, the more that I think I have so much fun streaming and playing the waiver wire through the year. It's something that, look, I love draft season. Draft is great. But you win your championships through the rest of the season, making the right moves, starting the right guy, picking up the right waiver claims. And in that system, a one quarterback league provides more fun for a longer period of time. So I'm going to say one quarterback, more fun.
Official? Is that your final answer?
Yeah, that's official.
One quarterback's officially more fun. They can write it down, put
it's
in
science.
The book.
It's easily scientific. Provable.
Yeah, this is not opinion.
All right. Well, that does it for today's show. I'm really excited about Thursday. We got Pat Mayo, the Fantasy Sports Network, coming on the show. We're going to be talking tiers. You guys have asked so much about tiers, and we've broken down all of our rankings, all of our tiers. You can see our rankings on the website, fantasyfootballers.com. You can see our tiers in the Ultimate Draft Kit, ultimatedraftkit.com. And we're going to be talking through some of the tier information, asking Pat Mayo about some of these bubble guys. Do they belong in tier one or tier two? Do they belong in tier three or tier four? Where should they be? Because that's how you make a lot of really smart decisions while you're drafting in your leagues. When you're trying to decide between positions, it's the tiers that really help you figure that out. And so if you don't know what we're talking about, we're going to give a good overview of tiers on Thursday. We'll talk through our rankings and our tiers, and I'm excited for that. So it's going to be a lot of fun. Coming up, a couple of shows ahead of that, we're going to have a mock draft episode again.
Yep.
One of the most favorite episodes of anybody who's listened to the show, because you see all the thought process that goes behind picking players. And we might have some special guests on the show as well. We're still confirming some of that.
Yeah, we're still working it out. It will be over the top. I mean, the Foot Clan will lose their mind. And a final reminder, please, podcastawards.com. Vote for the Fantasy Footballers Daily for Best Sports now, and People's Choice. And verify your
email. If you couldn't tell from Mike's voice right there, he actually is physically sustained by the votes that you cast. Unlike Jason and I, who were more departed from it, Mike was, you could tell, he had very little energy because a vote had not been cast in the last 15 minutes, and he actually eats the votes.
This means all things to Mike.
It's everything. It's his ability to, taunt your wife on a regular basis about
being an
award-winning podcaster.
Oh, that will be probably a daily occurrence.
So, okay, before we close, I'm going to give you the chance to do this because on the show after the show, we're talking about Game of Thrones. And so I want you to tell your story about your parenthood moment.
Oh, we're jumping to that?
Yeah, I want you to talk about your son, if you don't mind. You tweeted it.
All right, so
it's quite the conundrum.
So, Foot Clan, we often talk about adventures of being a dad, and I had a situation arise where I had to think very quickly. I had to make my decision in the blink of an eye. I don't know if you had caught my tweet a week or so ago that I said I was poking fun at my son. I mean, he's only five, and he was playing Mario Kart, and he was really bad. He's been practicing. And he is very good.
He stepped it up.
He got very good at that game very fast. But here's the deal. Your dad still reigns supreme.
Right.
Of the Super Mario Kart. And we're on a stage, and he ends up passing me. I am in second. We are on the final lap on basically the final stretch. I have a straightaway. I have the red shell locked and loaded.
Kill him.
And like I said, straightaway, there's nowhere he can go to avoid it.
And he's heading toward the finish line.
If I shoot it, he goes down, probably drops into like fourth, and then I would be in first place. And I had to decide, do I let my son win, or do I, teach him that life is not fair? I restrained. I let him take the win. And you know what I was rewarded with for what I thought was the right thing to do? He jumps up. He is standing on the chair, and he says, "Dad, I won." I was like, "Yeah." He says, "In your face, Dad!"
Sounds like you're his dad.
Yeah.
I mean, your son.
I was hurt, but I was also very proud that I got the in your face. But it's like, you don't even know what I could. I could have ruined your day.
I think you made the right call, my friend. You took the humble route, and now you'll have to teach that route to your son.
It was tough.
Next time you win and jump up on the chair yourself. So. See you guys.
Thank you for listening to another edition of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Don't forget to visit us on the web at www.thefantasyfootballers.com and follow us on Twitter at the FFBallers.